Yes, children. So we are coming towards the end of the syllabus. So the last chapter that we are going to see is hydrogen. And we are not going to study preparation and properties of hydrogen, but instead we will take up a particular topic, that is hydrides, and then we will see about water in this chapter. Okay. So now let us see what are hydrides. Hydrides are nothing but compounds of hydrogen with any other element, is it not? So these hydrides are of three types: ionic hydrides, covalent hydrides, and metallic hydrides or interstitial hydrides. Right? Now ionic hydrides, they are also called as salt-like hydrides. They are sodium hydride, calcium hydride, potassium hydride, they are all ionic hydrides, where you will find hydrogen is existing in the form of H-, that is hydride ion. And these ionic hydrides, they are powerful reducing agents, especially at high temperature. Now coming to covalent hydrides. Covalent hydrides are further classified into three types. You have electron deficient hydrides, electron precise hydrides, and electron rich hydrides. Now under this category, when you say electron deficient hydrides, B2H6, this is called as diborane. This is actually BH3 twice. Diborane, BH3 is borane, just like CH4 is methane, alkane. So like that, this BH3 is borane. And since two units are together, it is called as diborane. Okay. Now this is an electron deficient hydride. Now why it is an electron deficient hydride? Now look at the structure of this diborane. This is the structure. You have two boron atoms and there are four terminal hydrogen atoms. And these are in a single plane. Right? It is like this. See, I have shown another structure. The two boron atoms and the four terminal hydrogen atoms, they are in a single plane. And there are two hydrogen atoms above and below the plane. Now, these two hydrogen atoms are called as bridging hydrogen. And these four hydrogen atoms, they are called as terminal hydrogen atoms. Now, what is the specialty about this molecule is, now you know very well that boron is having three valence electrons. So one electron is shared with this hydrogen, another electron is shared with this hydrogen, and the third electron, it has to be shared with this hydrogen also, as well as this hydrogen also. Same way, this boron is also having its third electron. It should be shared with this also. It should be shared with this hydrogen also. So basically these two boron atoms are having just two electrons. And hydrogen is having only one electron, you know it. Either it has to share with this electron of boron or it has to share with this electron of boron. Right? So now what happens? Hydrogen is having only one electron. This hydrogen is also having one. This hydrogen is also having one. But both the hydrogen atoms are attached to both the boron atoms. So, supposing if you consider that the electron of hydrogen and the electron of boron are shared, it is not sharing only between these two. It is also sharing with this. So, there are only two electrons, but these two electrons are shared between three atoms. Same way, if you consider this is the electron of this boron and this is the electron of this hydrogen. Again, these two electrons are shared between these three atoms. Right? So, electrons are only two in number, but the atoms that is sharing these two electrons, they are three in number. Same way, electrons are two in number. The atoms which are sharing, they are three in number. So they are called two electron, three center bonds. And these are also called as banana bonds. Okay. Now, I'm just showing you another molecule. This is ethane. Now here and in this molecule, you see how many electrons are there. You will understand why this is an electron deficient molecule and this is an electron precise molecule. Electron precise means what is required is there. Electron deficient means it is short of electrons. Now you see here, 2 electrons here, 2 plus 2, 4, 4 plus 2, 8, 8 plus 2, 10. Then here there are total of 2 electrons and here there are a total of 2 electrons. So 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12. So there are only 12 electrons. Now see here, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14. So 14 electrons are there if each and every carbon, if it is attached to 3 atoms, then it should have 14 electrons. But look at this here. Here there are only 12 electrons. That is, it is short of 2 electrons. That is why these molecules are called as electron deficient molecules or electron deficient hydrides. Now all hydrocarbons, they come under the category of electron precise hydrides. Yes, you have octet configuration 2 4 6 8 2 4 6 8, everything is satisfied and you have precise number of electrons for the sharing purpose, so they are called as electron precise hydrides, and all hydrocarbons come under this category. And then the other category is electron rich hydrides. Now here you find hydrides of group 15, 16, 17. They all form this electron rich hydrides. Say for example NH3, water, H2S, HF, HCl. These are all electron rich hydrides. Why? Because there is a lone pair of electron on nitrogen. There are 3 lone pairs on fluorine of HF. There are 2 lone pairs on oxygen of water. So this is what is making them electron rich hydrides. Okay. So all these 3, they come under the category of covalent hydrides. All come under the category of covalent hydrides. Now, because of this peculiar arrangement of this molecule, diborane, it is a good reducing agent. Now look at this. These 4 terminal hydrogen atoms, they are in a planar structure. So the bond angle, HBH bond angle, is 120 on both the sides. Now this regular BH bond length is 119 picometer. And the bridging hydrogen, this BH bond and this BH bond, they are 134 picometer. That means it is longer than the terminal BH bonds. Now, if the bond is longer, what do you know? It is weaker. That means it can easily break. And that is the reason why B2H6 is a good reducing agent. Okay? It can give off hydrogen. So it is a good reducing agent. Anything that gives hydrogen is also a reducing agent, right? So diborane is a good reducing agent, especially in organic chemistry, you will see next year. So please remember this fact. The terminal 4 BH bonds are normal covalent bonds and they are strong because they are 2 center 2 electron bonds. But this BH bridging bonds, they are longer and weaker, and they are also called as banana bonds. It is appearing as if it is in the shape of a banana. That is why it is called as banana bonds. Now come to the third category, that is metallic hydrides or interstitial hydrides. Now what is meant by interstitial hydrides? Interstitial spaces ka matlab kya hai? So kisi bhi crystal lattice mein, when the atoms are arranged in a proper organized manner, there will be spaces in between the atoms, and those spaces are called as interstitial spaces, and the hydrogen atom is accommodated in the interstitial spaces of the crystal lattice of those metals. That is why they are called as interstitial hydrides, and they are non-stoichiometric. They are not present in measured quantities. Like you say a particular formula, it is in the ratio of 1 is to 2, CaH2. This is the ratio of 1 is to 2. Here it is in the ratio of 1 is to 1. So like that here you will not have. Here it is LaH2.87. So what kind of formula it is? In general what we say? We say LaH3. If I say like this, then this is stoichiometric because it is showing definite proportion 1 is to 3. But here it is 1 is to 2.87. Is that clear? That is why we say that they are all non-stoichiometric hydrides. They are not present in measured proportions. It ranges. Okay. Same way here, vanadium hydride, it is having just 0.56. So it is 1 is to 0.56. That is the proportion in which it is present. So generally these interstitial hydrides, they are formed by D block and F block elements. First group, second group elements and all, they will not make interstitial hydrides. So this is about the topic hydrides. Okay, you should know the classification and further classification if at all it is there, you should know, and you should know examples for each and every category. That is enough for hydrides. Now let us see water. And especially ice we are going to see. Now, you know that ice is a solid. Now, how the water molecules are arranged in ice. Say this is one water molecule, right? And it is having two lone pair of electrons on oxygen. Through one lone pair, it is attached to hydrogen of another water molecule. Then through this, the other lone pair, it is attached to another water molecule. Then this hydrogen is attached to lone pair of oxygen on another water. Same way this hydrogen is also attached to oxygen of another water molecule. So basically what you find, this oxygen is surrounded by four other oxygen atoms in a tetrahedral manner. Tetrahedral means what? Here there is one oxygen, here there is one oxygen, here there is one oxygen, here there is one oxygen. Like this you are having, is it not? This is the central one. Something like this you have, if you join like this, okay? So that is why you say the oxygen of each water molecule is surrounded by four other oxygen atoms tetrahedrally, leaving vacant spaces in between. See, this is a vacant space, right? Like this they are arranged and there are vacant spaces in between. So because of these vacant spaces, what you find? You find that the volume occupied is more because of these empty spaces. But there is no mass. They are all vacant. Is that clear? So density is less. Since the density of ice is low, it is floating on water. So this makes the density of ice less than that of water, and that is why ice floats on water. And this water has maximum density at 4 degrees. Okay, this also you should know. Now let's come to physical properties of water. Now you know very well that boiling point of water, freezing point is 0 degree, too low. Heat of vaporization of water, they are all abnormally high, right? Why so? Because of intermolecular hydrogen bonding. Water has a high specific heat, it also has a good thermal conductivity and its surface tension is also high. And it has a high dielectric constant. Now, what is dielectric constant? What is a dielectric substance? A dielectric substance, what it does? It does not allow two charged particles to come together. Like if you put NaCl in water, this Na plus and Cl minus will be surrounded by water. Is that clear? Now, because of the presence of water surrounding each ion, This Na plus and Cl minus, in spite of being oppositely charged, they cannot come closer to each other. So that is what is called as dielectric property. Dielectric, the two charges remain as two electric charges. That is the ability of water to maintain a distance between opposite charges. They cannot come together in spite of having opposite charge. And because of this property, it has the ability to dissolve many compounds in it. And so water is considered to be a universal solvent. Now, what are the kind of interactive force when you say about this dielectric constant? It may be ion-dipole interaction if the compounds are ionic in nature, like Na plus surrounded by water. Water is a dipole, this is an ion, so an ion surrounded by so many dipoles. So it is ion-dipole interaction. And if they are covalent compounds, say for example, you are talking about oxygen in alcohol. Now through the lone pair of oxygen, it can be bonded to hydrogen of water. That is why you say alcohol is soluble in water. Yes, that is through hydrogen bonds in the case of covalent compounds. Now when you come to chemical properties, quickly we will go through it. Number one, stability. Water is quite stable at ordinary temperature, but it decomposes at high temperature. Supposing you want to electrolyze water, then it needs high temperature. Either you have to pass electricity or you have to provide high temperature if it has to decompose. Then water is amphoteric in nature. See, it is reacting with ammonia. Here it is behaving as if it is an acid. And with H2S also it is reacting. And here it is taking up proton. So here it is acting as a base. A base is a proton acceptor. An acid is a proton donor. Here it is acting as an acid. And here it is acting as a base. Okay, a base is a proton acceptor. It pulls out a proton from here and becomes H3O+. And here it gives a proton to NH3 and it forms NH4+. And so you say it is amphoteric in nature. Right? Now, if you consider water, it undergoes autoproteolysis. Now two water molecules when you consider, it will form H3O+ and OH-. Right? So here this water is acting as an acid. It gives up proton to this. So this becomes H3O+. And after giving H+, what is left behind is OH-. So OH- is the conjugate base of this acid. And H3O+ is the conjugate acid of this base. Then, water can act as an oxidizing agent. It can also act as a reducing agent. Now, if you react sodium with water, you get NaOH and hydrogen. Here, water is acting as an oxidizing agent. What does an oxidizing agent do? It oxidizes a particular substance and gets itself reduced. So here, from zero, the charge on Na is 0, it is increasing to +1. So Na is oxidized. Then carbon having 0 charge, when it comes to CO form, it is having +2 charge. Again, there is oxidation. So it is acting as an oxidizing agent. Now water can also act as a reducing agent. Like if you show reaction with fluorine, you will get F2. Here the oxidation state of F is 0. And it gets converted to -1. That is, it is decreased. So F2 is reduced to F-. Right? And here O2- is getting increased to 0. So here there is increase in oxidation state. That is why water is acting as a reducing agent. And F2 to F-, there is decrease in oxidation state. So this is getting reduced. Then apart from this, you have water can hydrolyze many oxides, hydrides, nitrides, carbides, all that to form acids and bases. So that's what I have shown. Oxides or hydrides or nitrides, what all it gives. Then it also forms hydrates. Now these hydrates are of three types, either coordinated water और हाइड्रोजन बॉन्डेड वाटर और इंटरस्टीशियल वाटर. दीज आर द थ्री टाइप्स. ओके, सो हियर वाटर मॉलिक्यूल इज कोऑर्डिनेटली बॉन्डेड टू निकल विद इन द कोऑर्डिनेशन स्फीयर. सेम वे हियर वाटर इज कोऑर्डिनेटली बॉन्डेड टू कॉपर विद इन द कोऑर्डिनेशन स्फीयर. Hydrogen bonded means, supposing you are talking about copper sulfate 5H2O, here you find 4 inside the square and sulfate is there outside. Now this sulfate and this water, they are attached through hydrogen bonding to another water molecule. So this is hydrogen bonded water. Then interstitial water, BaCl2.2H2O, the H2O molecules are present in the interstitial spaces of the crystal lattice. This is what is called as interstitial water. So this is how the different hydrates are formed, right? So there ends your chapter.